Thank you. Could I please ask the members of the public who have been visiting our proceedings this lunchtime to please leave the gallery quietly and quickly, because we are about to continue our business, and I would appreciate your cooperation. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. We will move on to the next item of business, and the next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 11697 in the name of Mark Ruskell on site-specific just transition for Mossmorran. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button, and I call on Mark Ruskell to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank members that have signed the motion and are joining me in the chamber today to debate the future of Mossmorran petrochemical site. Now, this is an issue that I've been working on since being re-elected to Parliament in 2016, initially focusing on the noise pollution caused by flaring affecting neighbouring communities, then moving on to the health and safety risks experienced by workers, and finally now I'm working on the prospect of delivering a just transition for the site. And I also welcome the work of other members on this issue as well, including yourself, Deputy Presiding Officer, in your role as constituency MSP. The latest research into North Sea oil and gas commissioned by the Scottish Government shows a rapidly declining basin. This decline in fossil fuel reserves is irrefutable, and our choice now is whether we accept a slow withering of skills and expertise, or we grasp the opportunity to safeguard workers' jobs and maximise the growth of employment opportunities in both renewables and industrial decarbonisation. Now, as UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres stated, we need climate action on all fronts, everything, everywhere, all at once. We don't have the luxury of focusing on just one region or just one industrial site. Workers across Scotland, including at Mossmorran, deserve the assurance that their jobs too will be safeguarded in our transition to net zero. So, any credible plan for industrial decarbonisation in Scotland must tackle emissions at Mossmorran. The two plants directly employ approximately 250 workers, and many other workers are employed on a short-term basis from other parts of Scotland and overseas. Now, the UK Climate Change Committee reported that the industry is the second highest emitting sector in Scotland, with Mossmorran site, operated by Shell and ExxonMobil, being responsible for nearly 10% of Scotland's total climate change emissions. Now, in 2022, I commissioned the group Transition Economics to produce a report on Mossmorran, which looked at decarbonisation pathways for the site. These included carbon capture and storage, blue hydrogen and bioethanol. And all decarbonisation options had risks and trade-offs. But it was clear that a fairer, greener future was possible for Mossmorran, its workers and the local community. And the report concluded that planning the net zero future of the site needs to begin as quickly as possible, with operators, workers, unions and governments all brought together around the table. So, in October last year, I organised a summit facilitated by Dr. Daria Shapovalova, who's the coordinator of the Just Transition Lab at Aberdeen University. And that summit brought together workers, unions, NGOs and the Just Transition Commissioners together in Lochgelly to start the conversation. And I wanted to understand what their priorities were for that Just Transition plan at Mossmorran. Now, all the participants called for a meaningful transition for the site that is first and foremost led by workers and properly funded by both industry and government. And they cautioned against just transition being used as an empty slogan and warned us of what might happen if there is a further delay to real, tangible actions. The workers and unions highlighted the urgency of engaging with operators to collaborate on the development and the delivery of a plan for the site. Now, the operator of the Mossmorran plant, Shell and Exxon, are amongst the world's largest oil and gas operators, reporting profits in the billions just last month. But we've not yet seen the level of commitment needed by the operators to make a genuine transition at Mossmorran happen. Now, the operators have signed up to the Acorn carbon capture and storage cluster, and we're waiting a progress on the bid in track two that could allow Grangemouth and Mossmorran to feed in. Now, questions remain about the effectiveness of CCS, but if this project can meet the highest standards for capture, then it could provide a major part of the decarbonisation pathway. But in a meeting that I held with both operators shortly after that first summit, it was clear that there is a lack of communication between them and the workforce on these matters. Where does Mossmorran sit in their global portfolio of sites awaiting CCS and other investments? What opportunities would there be for the workforce around skills development or retraining under such a plan? So many questions remain unanswered, and the operators still need to convince the workforce and the community that decarbonisation will actually happen. Now, just this week, Exxon's chief executive blamed the public for the failure to tackle the climate emergency, claiming Exxon and other oil and gas giants, I quote, have opportunities to make fuels with lower carbon in it, but people aren't willing to spend the money to do that. But it's painfully obvious to me that it's those who make the mega profits from oil and gas who are unwilling to spend enough of this profit on the transition that they have to make to a greener future. Now, we had plans to host the second summit tomorrow, which would welcome all the participants from our initial summit, as well as the site operators, five council national governments. But despite the welcome interest from the minister and government officials to attend the summit, the site operators, Exxon and Shell, have declined our invitation. Now, their decision not to come to the table is disappointing. How can we have faith that private companies will invest in the just transition that we so desperately need if they fail to do the bare minimum and join the conversation? What we've seen recently at Grangemouth should be enough of a warning to us all. We can't just sit in our hands. The future of Mossmorran cannot be decided behind closed doors. It needs to be planned early, and it needs to be planned openly. And earlier this week, we agreed that we will keep going ahead with another summit later this year. We'll keep working with Unite, JMB, Just Transition Commissioners, and the STUC to ensure that everyone is around the table. And I'd like to publicly extend an invitation again to the Minister, to other MSPs, the two site operators, to come and be part of that conversation. The government's transition work at Grangemouth has been welcome, but it must be accelerated to other sites across Scotland where emissions are vast, where the single steps towards a net zero, the biggest single steps towards net zero, must be made. We've no time to waste. It is our duty to map out the alternative future for sites like Mossmorran, and we must do so in a fair and just manner that leaves no workers and local communities behind. Inaction is not an option. I will continue to take this duty seriously, and I hope that many joining me in this chamber today will do the same.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell. I now call David Torrance to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Mark Ruskell for bringing this motion to the chamber today to discuss an issue of its paramount importance to our country, our environment and our future. The Mossmorran petrochemical site is a significant contributor to Scotland's industrial emissions, accounting for nearly 10% of our national total. This figure is just not a statistic. It is a call for urgent action in our journey towards a sustainable and resilient Scotland. The Paris Agreement, which aims to limit global temperatures increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius and well below 2 degrees Celsius, is merely an international obligation to a moral imperative for Scotland. To meet these ambitious goals, rapid and sustained reductions in emissions across all sectors, including the industry, are non-negotiable. As the second highest emitter sector in our country, the industry sector transformation is not just necessary, it is inevitable. At the heart of the transformation is the Mossmorran site. Located just outside my constituency, the site embodies both our industrial strengths and our environmental challenges. The path forward is clear. We must identify a decarbonised pathway for Mossmorran, one that develops collaborative with operators, workers, unions and local and national government. And this pathway is just not about reducing emissions, it's about setting a precedent of how industry in Scotland adapts to realities of climate emergency. The concept of just transition is central to this discussion. It's a principle that ensures the shift towards a low-carbon economy is fair, inclusive and leaves no one behind. For the workers at Mossmorran, and indeed across Fife and Scotland's industrial sector, this transition is not just a challenge, but an opportunity to sustain jobs, for innovation and for a healthier environment and communities. The Mossmorran site, with its 250 direct employees and many more engaged through short-term maintenance contracts, stands as a microcosm of a border of challenges facing our industrial workforce in the face of decarbonisation. These workers are not just mere cogs in the industrial machine. They are skilled, dedicated individuals whose knowledge and expertise are invaluable assets to our journey towards net zero. And this is why I very much welcome the announcement that the Scottish Government will be boosting the Just Transition Fund by an extra £25 million to ensure a fair and just transition for the energy sector. As many will know, my constituency in Kirkcaldy and the surrounding areas in Fife have seen great industrial, economic and societal changes over the last century. The history of this area is deeply interwoven with the coal mining industry, and for better or worse, we are familiar with the challenges and inevitable arises which changes in the energy landscape. The legacy of the closure of the mines in Kirkcaldy and throughout Scotland is very well known, and it is just not an economic blow, it is a cultural, a social one. It left behind a legacy of unemployment, social challenges and a community grappling with its identity and future. Therefore, the process of transitioning Mossmorran, and indeed all Scotland's industrial sites, to low-carbon operations must be led by those who know it best, the workers themselves. A worker-led transition is the only way to ensure that the move to green jobs is done in a way that respects the dignity, expertise and the needs of our workforce. This transition will not be easy. It requires substantial investment, not just in technology, in people. As a former mechanical engineer in the oil and gas industry, I am accurately aware of the importance of training and reskilling programmes, which must be at the heart of our just transition strategy, ensuring that Scotland's workforce is ready to meet the demands of a low-carbon economy. Additionally, we must ensure that our new green jobs are secured, well-paid and accessible to all, particularly those currently employed in high-emission industries. The role of CARB collaborative in this process cannot be overstated. The decarbonisation of Mossmorran and the industrial sector more broadly must be a joint effort between government, industry, workers and the community. Each stakeholder brings unique insights and resources to the table, making our collective action stronger and more effective. It is also crucial to remember the communities living in the shadow of Mossmorran. Fife, with its rich history and vibrant community, finds itself at the forefront of Scotland's journey towards a greener future. Any transition plans must include measures to protect these communities from environmental and health impacts, ensuring that they too benefit from Scotland's green transformation. In conclusion, the journey towards net zero Scotland by 2045 is filled with challenges, but also unparalleled opportunities. The decarbonisation of Mossmorran represents a crucial step in that journey, serving as a blueprint for how we can transform Scotland's industry and landscape in a way that is sustainable, equitable and just.
Thank you, Mr Torrance. I call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Alec Riley. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I first thank Mark Ruskell for bringing this members' debate today. I think it's important that we have this debate because, as we've seen from the announcement that was made on Grangemouth, these facilities are not going to be around forever. The planning process for what next for the workforce and for the local area needs to be taking place now. So, in theory, we can have a smooth transition from one industry to the next. And can I start by thanking the workforce of Mossmorran? The plant plays a key role in delivering on the existing UK energy needs, with 80% of UK homes still relying on natural gas to keep them warm. But of course, it's not just heating, Presiding Officer. The work at Mossmorran goes towards the production of tyres, deodorants, cooking fuel, car windscreens, fuel packaging, detergents and anaesthetic for medical procedures. So we have much to be thankful for. And it's these facts that demonstrate why sites like Mossmorran in our oil and gas industry are so incredibly important. But it's not just about the production of vital goods, but the highly skilled, well-paid jobs that contribute to local economies. Presiding Officer, I think everyone in the Chamber agrees that we need to stop burning fossil fuels, and that will take time. I think where we sometimes disagree is how we get there. Mr Ruskell takes a hard stance against any new licences in the North Sea, actually a position shared by Labour and the SNP. But I feel while there's still a demand, we should rightly focus on reducing that demand, but also that our consumption of oil and gas products is done in a way that causes least harm to the environment. And that's why I think it is important to note the work Shell especially has done to decarbonise the yard, but I'm sure they can go further. It will always be a large consumer of energy and emissions, so the more the yard can do to reduce those emissions will impact significantly Scotland's overall emissions. So Mark Ruskell makes a good point about bringing all the players together to develop a decarbonisation pathway. Personally, I haven't been to Mossmorran, but I have been to meet Petri Ineos at Grangemouth, and I was impressed by how much work they were doing in decarbonisation. A huge programme and a huge investment to match. Maybe Mossmorran has the same. If so, then great, but then maybe those plans should be shared more widely. So it's strange that Shell and Exxon are not engaging in the process that Mark Ruskell set out. And Mr. Ruskell is also right to highlight the contractor workforce in his motion. I think too often it's only the direct workforce that is taken into account when planning for a site's future. But we need to consider the wider economic impact of a facility. And that goes even further than the contractors. It's those indirectly related jobs in nearby communities. Taxi drivers, hairdressers, bartenders, teachers have to be taken into account when we look at a transition to make sure that no one is left behind. A Unite survey of workers in Grangemouth showed that only 3% of the workers expressed confidence in this government's just transition plans for oil and gas workers. So there is clearly more that can be done. And it will be good to hear from the Minister what discussions the government has had with Shell and ExxonMobil on the future of these facilities. In the case of Grangemouth, it appears that the government were warned what was coming from Petro Ineos, but failed to get ahead of the game and start the planning process for the workforce earlier. In conclusion, I agree with Mark Ruskell that the future planning of the future of Mossmorran and the community that depend on it must start now. I hope that can be done in a cross-party, consensus way with everyone at the table. I think we owe it to the community and workers of Mossmorran to ensure a safe economic future. And I look forward to hearing from the government what progress has been made to date. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. And I now call Alec Riley. Mr. Riley.
Presiding Officer, I would also congratulate Mark Ruskell in securing this debate today. Ultimately, I believe today's debate should focus less on the specific site of Mossmorran and more on a Scotland and indeed UK-wide approach to decarbonisation and the just transition. Because put simply, we will not achieve the just transition that Scotland needs if we continue to approach this issue on a case-by-case, site-specific basis without greater effort to take in the big picture. Policy without strategy will lead only to failure, and I'm afraid that policy without strategy and without action seems to be often the order of the day. What is clear is that if we are to meet our climate targets, and in Scotland we need both the Scottish and UK governments to work together with a joint focus, a joined-up strategy, and with clarity and consistency that will secure the investment needed to reach those goals. I also believe there needs to be further clarity on what is meant by a just transition. From the discussions I've had with trade unions and employers, whether that be in oil and gas or in the renewable sectors, the greatest challenge they tell me that they face right now is the massive shortage of skilled labour across all these sectors. Only this week I was in Methil, where they're hoping to do a lot of work that will come or should come from the renewable sector. But skills and being able to get skilled labour is a massive issue for them. So whether you're a welder in Mossmorran Welding Steel or you're a welder in Methil, if you can't get the welders or the technicians, then therein lies a major difficulty. Decarbonisation and just transition is not being met with much resistance, it seems to me, by many of the companies that I have spoken to. But they are clear that they rely on government to make the just transition happen, whether that's Scottish or UK governments. And where there is resistance, I strongly believe it stems from the concerns that the Scottish and UK governments are not driving the progress necessary to make the just transition feasible, despite paying a lot of lip service to the green credentials that they both espouse to. I regularly speak with businesses and trade unions who are involved in the sectors that are crucial to the just transition. Unless we move away from the current piecemeal approach, where bits of policy take the place of long-term strategy, and give this the attention and the resources it demands, businesses cannot plan for the future. The Just Transition Partnership summarised the issues clearly. Have we got?
Yeah. Yep, yes. Yeah. Mark Ruskell.
I thank Alec Rowley for giving way, and I certainly don't disagree with his argument that we need an industrial strategy that binds the two governments working in Scotland together and works with industry. But would he not accept, though, that for Mossmorran, for that ethylene production site, we do actually need a plan. We do need a plan that decarbonises that particular site, as well as a wider industrial strategy that includes Scotland, and that has to come from the workers. It has to come from those who've spent their careers operating that site. They understand it intricately. They know what the skills are that are going to be required to affect that transition. They know what the technical solutions might be as well.
Alec Rowley, I'll give you time back.
Interestingly, the workers that I have spoken to, what they're really frightened of, because if you look at the age range within much of these workforces in the sector, what they're frightened of is that they're going to retire and the skills are going to go with them. What they want is they want to see a clear industrial strategy that will give young people the opportunities to get those skills and take those skills forward. And so the skills agenda and the industrial strategy for me are absolutely key to this. But there has to then be certainty from both the Scottish and UK government in terms of what investment's going to go in terms of, and I'll come on to this, in terms of your own paper where you set out some of the solutions that could be there. So the government should not start from the assumption that a just transition is just going to happen one way or another. There is much more work that needs to be done before we can start to look at the site-specific plans to do little more than shift responsibility for achieving a just transition away from government that has to play its part if we're going to succeed. For example, carbon capture and storage and hydrogen as an energy source have not been deployed at a swift enough pace. And these are two elements that are instrumental, it seems to me, in the report that Mark Ruskell commissioned. And companies across the UK are battling over a smaller pool of skilled labour that would be needed to be in place if we were going to make this just transition actually happen. And then there is the contradictions that ultimately arise when there is no unifying strategy to rely on. Ministers, for example, are currently considering an application for a new gas plant at Peterhead that seems to fly in the face of anything the Scottish Government has said on achieving net zero by 2045 and was described at the end of last year as a climate disaster. So how does this proposal fit into the just transition that we all say we desire? I'm deeply passionate about this issue, Presiding Officer, but I do want to avoid a climate disaster, so I do believe we have to take action. But for me, if I conclude by saying, if we are serious about achieving our climate goals, it is crucial that this government, working with the UK government, gives this subject the time and the attention and the clarity that is needed.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. I now call on Minister Julian Martin to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank, as everyone has, by thanking Mark Ruskell for bringing this debate to the Chamber today. And to him for the insightful and encouraging discussion on Mossmorran Industrial Site, and not just from Mark Ruskell and the work that he's done on this over the years, as he outlined, but from all members who have spoken today. And I wish that we could have this kind of debate more often, where I'm actually finding it very difficult to disagree with anything that anyone has said. I think we've got a shared goal, and I think the just transition of our industries, our high-carbon industries in Scotland, needs that political consensus. It needs us to all get our shoulder behind the wheel and having a shared vision on what we want to achieve, because the economic opportunities that are out there for Scotland are vast. But the economic peril is also there if we don't do that. So I'm very pleased with how this debate has gone, and I hope that continues into other discussions around this. It's indeed critical to secure a truly just transition for Mossmorran, and working with all the relevant stakeholders to work on that. Everyone has to be in the room. Mark Ruskell is absolutely right. Members are more than familiar with the important role that the Mossmorran site plays in contributing to the local economy. And, Doug Slumsman mentions he's never been there. I'm going there at the end of the middle of this month, but I have been there in my previous role before politics, when I was helping Shell make some safety videos. So I've been at Mossmorran before, and I'm aware of how central it is to the local economy. And I think that there was a very good point made by Douglas Rumsden about the wider economic impact. It's not just the workers that are there, it's the workers who I pay tribute to, but it's the wider community as well. And that's a just transition. It's never just about one site, it's about the impact on the wider community. I think it's been mentioned that the Mossmorran has a critical role to play in the Scottish cluster and the CCUS, but there are other potential activities that can transition the plant, and I am keen to discuss them in detail when I go and meet with ExxonMobil and Shell at the Mossmorran plant later this month. We are committed as a government to achieving a just transition to net zero emissions by 2045. Members will know that only very recently I was given responsibility for just transition as well as energy and fair work. I was absolutely delighted to see all of those things coming together, because as Energy Minister since March last year, just transition has been inextricable from my portfolio there, and the fact that they've come together. And like Alec Rowley, I'm passionate about this too. You know, I come from the North East where there has to be a just transition, and I recognise that other members across Scotland have got key sites and sectors, that high carbon sectors, that need similar attention to North Sea oil and gas in this respect. But it is right that Mossmorran is, of course, I recognise Mossmorran is responsible for 8.4% of Scotland's industrial emissions, and so we have to look at how the emissions are reduced of the plant as operating right now, and I think there's a great deal of work and investment been done on that already. But we also have to look into the future. There is less demand for plastic, for example. There's less demand for plastic packaging that is driven by consumers. That will have a knock-on effect on the operations for Mossmorran as well. And I imagine that Alec Rowley, when he was talking about being in methyl, was at Harland and Wolff. I believe. In fact, I know that because they told me. I'm not that psychic. But a really interesting situation in Harland and Wolff, where they are poised ready to make the jackets for turbines out in the North Sea. And they actually do a tremendous amount of work in... they've got a tremendous amount of apprentices working with them. But I pay tribute as well for the work of Forth Valley College and Fife College in upskilling the young workforce. And I think it's absolutely right that we utilise the skills and experience of the existing workforce in all our high-emitting industrial sites to help upskill young people when they come in. Yes, I will.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Minister, for taking the intervention. H100 in my constituency is a great example of hydrogen and how it's going to be used for heating our homes, which is one of the largest contributors to greenhouse gas emissions. The partnership between Fife College and Scottish Gas in training the new generation of engineers in hydrogen, is that not a great example? It should be replicated across Scotland.
Minister.
Yeah, I thank David Torrance for that intervention. I visited H100 in summer of last year, and I think it's a tremendously exciting project. I think that they are really working well with the local community in Methil as well. I know that they've had the amount of subscribers to be a part of the project that they hoped for. It's an example of a company working in a community, not just to facilitate a just transition, but to have the benefits of that transition spread amongst the community. And I thank David Torrance for mentioning that project. David Torrance also pointed to the importance of reducing emissions from our industries, but he points to the opportunities. We cannot ignore these opportunities. That's what just transition is about. It sometimes can be talked about in negative terms. I think we've really got to start talking about it in positive terms. Everything is there for the taking, and that's why both UK government and Scottish government have to work together. and have to put investment where it's needed. I want to point to some of the investment that that we today, I mean, the energy, Scottish Industrial Energy Transformation Fund offers matched funding for targeted projects. To date, £16 million has been offered as grants as part of a £43 million investment across 27 projects. But there's more to be done as well. We've got £500 million of just transition money for the North East, but we also have to be looking at what we can be doing to spread the learning of what's happening in the North East beyond other sites. Can I take you in just a second? I also want to mention that we need clarity on when the CCUS Scottish Cluster project is going to be given the status that is required for people to be making these decisions and investment as well. And on that note, I'll bring in Douglas Lumsden.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank the Minister for taking my intervention. It's, obviously the Minister had mentioned the £500 million Just Transition Fund for the North East, which is good for a North East MSP. But I guess other people watching this might think, well, what about my area? What about Mossmorran? So what could the government do to help other areas, not just in the North East?
Minister.
Well, there's a great deal of... So the Green Industrial Strategy is going to be rolled out in the summer of this year, which will actually address that point as well, because we have to recognise it's not just the North East that, that faces... has opportunities, yes, but faces some difficulties if we don't get just transition for oil and gas workers right. But off the back, when we talk about that wider community, the oil and gas workers in the North East are also the oil and gas workers are linked to the petrochemical workers in Grangemouth and Mossmorran as well. They're all part of the same sector, so we have to make sure that we actually include them as well. I think that Grangemouth's been mentioned, and I want to come on to that in particular. We're currently working with partners across the Grangemouth Future Industry Board to develop a just transition plan for the industrial cluster located there. And I want to explain why we are prioritising that at the moment. Because Grangemouth is a significantly larger cluster and home to multiple industrial operators, our largest port, significant links to the transport sector. And also some decisions are being made, as we all know, about the future of the refinery there. There will be learning in that process for Mossmorran. You know, we are obviously prioritising Grangemouth at the moment, but that doesn't mean to say that we are not looking at what's happening in Mossmorran. That's part of the reason for my visit there, and I am very interested to hear what plans the operators have for the plant, particularly in low-carbon technologies. I'm very interested in what they might be doing in the hydrogen space. I'm very interested... from their perspective, how they might be contributing to CCUS. Our experience and approach taken in developing the Grangemouth Industrial Just Transition Plan has highlighted the importance of comprehensive engagement planning and creating conditions for co-design to succeed. And I want to go back to something that David Torrens said about a transition being worker-led. I agree with that 100%. We cannot do this without the engagement and the buy-in of the workers and their associated unions as well. And I've had an early conversation with Ross Foyer from the STUC about the just transition element of my portfolio and how I can work more closely with the unions, all the unions working in all these areas, and how we might do that effectively. We have been clear that trade union and worker representation in all our just transition plans is going to be absolutely critical. And this is the approach we've taken in the energy strategy and just transition plan. I want to assure Alec Rowley that what he's talked about in terms of a high-level strategic plan will be addressed in the energy strategy and just transition plan, which we hope to, well, we are going to produce early summer. We are already adopting the approach that we have in the draft plan in the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth. But I just want to come back to, before I close, Presiding Officer, to something I think that was said by Douglas Lumsden, and goes back to my initial point about political consensus. Political consensus on this is what the workers want. They're what the public wants. I think we have to sometimes steel ourselves and stop making so many political points, because the workers and the stakeholders are watching what we do. We need to work in partnership with our local authorities, the unions, the workers. Both governments have to work hand in hand. And that also means both governments putting in significant investment as well. I would have liked to have seen the £28 billion pledge remain. I am sure that my Labour colleagues in these benches would have as well. And I'm not making a political point there. I'm just saying that if we have a situation where we have a change in UK government, I would urge colleagues in Scotland to make the point that Scotland has to be central to that green and any green investment that comes from a new UK government. But I can see that the presiding officer would like me to end, and I will leave it there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate. I suspend this meeting until 2:30 p.m. Thank you.